Our pastor is ready to teach and preach the word of God to us today. And the ground is tilled and is fertile for a miracle. Those y'all connected for real, can you can feel him. Those of y'all that are not just here, but you're connected for real, you can feel him right now. Everything that's not committed is leaving. I'm telling you. The stress is leaving off of you because you're trying to make people to commit. Watch it, Pastor. It's leaving. It's leaving. It's leaving. It's leaving. It's leaving. Every uncommitted member, every uncommitted person, that weight is leaving. That struggle is leaving off of your heart right now. I'm sending faithful people. I'm sending lovable, accountable people that won't steal the anointing. Cut it down. People won't steal the anointing and the atmosphere and leave. Won't commit, won't tithe. Those people are leaving. Your heart, your mind, and your spirit, saith the Spirit of the Lord, and peace shall rest upon you. And you will preach or teach to one, two, or three with power and the anointing of God and the fire of God and the passion of God, like there was 300 to 3,000 people. For the mantle shifts now. We were waiting, but God said it shifts now. Oh, God, come on, lift your voices all over the house. The weight. Oh, my shikata la ba shata. Oh, come on, not enough prayer for it, not enough worship for it. It's going to shift now. And if you love your leader, I dare you to send up a worship.
just begin to bless his name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on and give him glory. Come on and give him the glory. Hallelujah. Come on and give him praise. Come on, he's worthy of the glory. He's worthy to be lifted. Hallelujah. Come on, give him the glory.
It's turning around.
Hallelujah. Somebody shout, it's turning around.
I can feel it happening.
I can't even explain fully what God is doing or what he's done, but hallelujah. Come on, just worship him for a moment. Father, we bless your name. Come on and give him glory. Come on, he's worthy. He's worthy of the praise. Hallelujah. Come on and bless his name. This is prophetic ministry, as Pastor Latoya said. We don't know how God is going to move. Come on and bless his name. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Jesus. Father, we bless your name. Lord, we honor you. And God, we give you all the glory and the praise and the worship . That's more. We will explain and go into more details later, but amen. I can't figure out God. Amen. I don't know what God going to do, when he going to do it, how he going to do it. Sometimes we serve a God, it seems like he don't make any sense, but in the long run, some kind of way, stuff will start making sense. Amen, somebody? Hallelujah. Amen. Let's thank God for what God has done so far in the service. Come on. He wrecked this place in a matter of 15 minutes. Nobody can do you like God can. Hallelujah. No one can do you like God can. I got up this morning. I was praying around 6:30, Pastor Latoya, and the Lord told me, he said, you know what? When you got a real vision from God, sometimes you got to expect the attacks of the enemy. He said, just don't think you're going to have a vision and people not going to come on assignment to try to cause division. He told me that plain and clear. He said, expect people to do witchcraft. He said, expect people to be warlocks and witches. He told me that. He said, when it's real vision from God, but he said, when they do it, it won't prosper. Somebody ought to give God praise. When you got a real vision from God, the enemy going to try to come and sow division, do witchcraft, hoodoo, warlocks, or whatever. But whatever been spoken against you to destroy you, to divide you, to kill your marriage, I can't get no help, nobody, to come against your body. Hallelujah. We come against it in the name of Jesus, and it shall not prosper. Are the weapons formed against you, but it won't prosper. It's formed against me, but somebody shout, it won't prosper. He said, you just can't fact, you have to factor in, somebody shout, spiritual warfare. I know we're talking about vision. We're going to continue to talk about that, but you can't talk about vision without dealing with spiritual warfare. The enemy just not going to let us have good and great church and people get delivered, set free, slain in the Holy Ghost, and he not try to come and divide. That's the enemy's job. He want to divide you. He want to separate you. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
Amen. Let's give God a hand of praise for Pastor Tori. Hallelujah. Come on, give a great round of applause. Hallelujah. Amen. My better half, and I'm honored, amen, to serve, amen, the Lord with. Amen. And we serve a great and mighty God. Somebody say, we serve a good God. Let's thank God for our chief apostle, Dr. Todd M. Hall. Come on, let's give him a great round of applause. Hallelujah. Let's thank God for Jesus Christ, the heavyweight champion of the world. Somebody give God praise for Jesus. Hallelujah. Can y'all hear me okay? Okay, amen. Y'all know anything about me, and men like new gadgets. So you got a husband, you want to make him happy, give him a new gadget. Amen. New gadgets, thingamajig thing or whatever. Amen. Amen. That new gadget might be a little tool. Although he might get disinterested in 2 or 3 minutes, don't get mad and upset because me and attention span is real short. Amen. So I got this little gadget. We're going to try to, amen, work with it. Amen, somebody. So I'm a little excited about it. I thought the Holy Ghost was going to interrupt me, and I wasn't going to get to play on this gadget. I'm like, well, God, do what you want to do. Amen. We'll try to play with it another Sunday. Amen. Hallelujah. But we serve a good God. I remember growing up as a kid. Amen. Every Christmas, my mom used to buy me a remote control car. That was my gadget. And that was my little gizmo. Hallelujah. And I just believe we serve a good God, and God going to have his way. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, say your situations are about to get better. Lately, we've been talking about vision. Somebody shout vision. And I don't really have a lengthy message prepared, but I want to say this. It's a difference between vision and ambition. Can somebody shout amen?
Amen?
Ambition is something that's a strong desire to achieve something.
Amen.
It's something that you want to do. And it's nothing wrong with being ambitious. But oftentimes, I've had it confused before. Just because you're ambitious in doing something don't mean that's a God-given vision.
Amen.
Can I get by 4 more amens?
Amen.
So what happened is we can be about ambitious about doing something, but God didn't give us that vision.
Oh,
hallelujah. So look at your name and say, neighbor.
Amen.
There is a difference between your vision and about being ambitious. And I believe this message today is for some visionaries. This message today is for some people who got some dreams. This message today is for some people who you know God spoke to you in the midnight hour. He spoke to you through your dreams and your vision. He spoke to you in a day vision. This is the message from people who know they got something locked up on the inside of them, and God's about to unlock it. Listen, if you don't got no vision, if you don't got no dream, if you don't got no ambition that was given by God, then this message is not going to be for you. If you want to stay settle, if you want to stay stuck, if you don't want no real change, if you don't want to experience God's favor and the best for your life, then this message is not for you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. If you want to stay where you are, if you want to stay depressed, if you want to stay mad, if you want to stay upset, if you want to stay sick, if you want to stay hurt, then this message is not for you. This message from people who want to go somewhere in their life.
Amen.
Somebody look at your neighbor and say, neighbor. And we got about 3 more. Say, I don't know about you, but I want to go somewhere in my life. Hallelujah. This message is for visionaries. It's for dreamers. And we all are familiar with the story of Joseph. I'm not going to go into all of it because it's a lengthy story, but I'm just going to recap on, highlight on certain areas. Amen. So if you would, I will ask you to turn it to, amen, Genesis 37, verse 7. When you're there, can I get you to shout amen? Yeah, Genesis 37, verse 7, amen. When you get there, you can shout amen. Like I say, this message is for visionaries. This message is for people, amen, who have a dream. And I believe God's going to allow our dreams and visions, somebody shout, to come to pass. And we all knew Joseph. Joseph was hated by his brethren. And the Bible say they could not speak peaceably about him.
Amen.
They couldn't speak peaceably about Joseph. We understand that. And not to, amen, jump ahead of myself, but sometimes I think we can be a little bit naive because we think family is supposed to support us.
Amen.
And we get distracted with the vision God gave us because it seemed like the closest people to us supposed to support us.
Right.
But what happened when you don't get that support that you want? What happened when you don't get that support you think you deserve? You help them fulfill their vision, but they can never help you fulfill your vision. What happens when you feel like you're the one who's given all the help, but you never receive any help? What happens when it seems like you feel the one who always paying for the tail, but no one ever pay for your tail? You feel like people start taking advantage of you. Verse 7. Amen. For behold, we were binding sheaves. Joseph began to tell his dreams in the field. And lo, my sheaf arose and also stood upright. And behold, your sheaves of wheat stood round about and bowed down to my sheaf. So Joseph told them this dream. In other words, they began to tell him, I'm going to paraphrase it, you must be crazy. You telling me that your dream is saying that I'm going to bow down to you. And some people have a misinterpretation. The real interpretation of Joseph's dream is that I'm going to be at a high level and I'm going to rescue you in the future. So you got to be careful who you share your dream with, because they only see the part that affects them. Let me say it like this. When you got a real vision from God, it includes more than just you. Let me break it down. See, when you're ambitious, glory be to God, you just got ambition and a vision for yourself. But when you got a God-given vision, sometimes it's going to sound crazy even to yourself. I guess ain't nobody ever had no kind of vision. When you told somebody, they looked at you sideways. And don't get mad at them, because you barely believe yourself. So how can you expect somebody else to believe you? Every vision needs at least one person to believe in it. If your mama don't believe in it, I got to believe in myself. If your husband don't believe in it, you got to believe in it. If I can't get no help, nobody. So sometimes God will give you a vision where no one else believes in it. Amen. They'll look at you crazy, but you. Amen. So what happened at Joseph? Like, Joseph, hold on, you must be crazy. We already don't like you because the Father favors you. So we definitely don't want to hear about your dream. I don't got time to hear about your petty dreams. I don't got time to hear about your petty visions. See, some people are mad because God ain't showing them nothing. Some people are mad because God keeps showing you stuff and stuff keeps coming to pass and God haven't showed them nothing. Well, if you serve the same God just like I do, and God has no respect to person, if you learn how to get in God's presence, then God will show you some stuff for your life. He'll give you a vision. But don't get mad at me because God's showing me stuff. I thought she was my bestie, and I thought I should at least be able to share my dream with you. I thought I could share my vision with you. I don't mind you looking at me crazy, but even I want you to get yourself together. Yeah, that's kind of wild, but if God be for you, it don't matter who against you. Can I get somebody to shout amen? Amen. So he said, basically, you're going to have dominion over us, Joseph. You saying we're going to be beneath you. And Joseph wasn't saying that in an arrogant kind of way. Joseph was saying that in a way, glory be to God, that at least one person out of the family got to be so blessed that he can bring all of us out. It don't matter who God chooses. As long as God anoint one, then they'll bring us all out. See, God can't choose some of us because we got selfish visions. Our vision is just about ourselves. Our vision is just about our family. Our vision is just about to have a white house and a picket fence. Our vision is just to get married. Your vision got to be bigger than you. When your vision is bigger than you, then God will get all in your vision. I don't know about you all, but I want God to get all in my sleeper. I want him to get all in my vision. I want him to get all and take the wheel and make me pull over. I want the glory of God all over my life. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, God's about to give you some visions. Gonna give you some dreams. And the Bible says in verse 9, he dreamed another dream. Somebody say, he keep dreaming. This boy keep on dreaming. Go to verse 9, 37 verse 9. And he dreamed yet another dream and told it to his brethren and said, behold, I've dreamed, I dream more. And behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars, they bowed down to me. And the Bible say his brothers envied him even the more, and they couldn't speak peaceably about him. Stop waiting on people's approval to speak peaceably about you. They just don't like some of y'all, but they hate some of y'all. Yeah. I don't like to say that because I don't like to be one of those people who try to develop my own enemies and act like I got 1,000 haters. But truth be told, some people do more than just dislike you. They envy you. They hate you. They hate to see you coming. Ooh, yeah. They hate you. They hate your kids. They hate your husband. Y'all ain't gonna help me. They hate the new car. And one thing about a hater, but I can't stand a private hater. Yeah. They'll give you praise in front of your face. But behind your back, you found out they was talking about you. They was trying to block you. They was trying to stop you. They was trying to sabotage you. They was trying to hoodwink you. We got to get rid of them private haters. Them private haters are the worst ones. Hallelujah. And I believe Joseph was a little bit naive, Pastor LaToya, because he kept telling his family the dreams that he had. Amen. So he must be naive to the fact that he didn't know that they just didn't dislike him, but they hated him. Amen. And sometimes you can be naive to the fact that the people you're close with, they do more than just dislike you, but they hate you. Amen. A little bit more volume, amen. They just don't dislike you, but they envy you. Amen. Hallelujah. They praying against it. They don't want to see it come to pass. No, your real vision, they don't want to see it come to pass. Someone say, not the real vision. So what happened was Joseph had a vision from God, and a real vision oftentimes, it'll make you look crazy. It'll make you look like you don't know what you're talking about. And it's weird how sometimes people will be mad and upset at you and you just talking about stuff you haven't even done yet. You mad at me. I'm just talking about doing it. And I feel your hatred towards me. I feel you hating on me. I can't get no help, nobody. I haven't even done it yet. God hasn't even graced me for the time to do it. I'm just talking and running my mouth. And I see you frowning up. That's the problem. Woo! Some people mad because you just talking about the stuff God gonna do for you in your life. If you just mad at me talking about it, how you gonna act when I really get it? How you gonna act when I drive in it? How you gonna act, glory be to God, when God get me the house? How you gonna act when I finally get the promotion? How you gonna act when I get married? How you gonna, I'm just talking about it and you mad at me. Adrian, I'm just talking about it. You just talking about it. You haven't even scratched the surface of being the man or the woman that God has called you to be. You haven't even scratched the surface of all your business endeavors. You just talking about it. You just putting it on paper and they're trying to stop you already. Truth be told, I think they may fear that it actually might come to pass. You actually might be, hallelujah, that person in that dream that you saw. And sometimes your success is people's biggest fears. That's from the Holy Ghost. Sometimes your success is your enemy's biggest fears. They don't want you to be successful. They want you to stay broke, stay upset, stay depressed. Stay in a pit, glory be to God, hallelujah. But God's about to allow you to experience a vision, and one day you're going to tell a vision. You're going to televise your vision. God's about to upgrade some of you all, and your vision about to sell. Your vision might be on TV one day. I can't get no help, nobody. Your vision might be on the radio one day. Your vision might be in every school one day. I don't know who I'm prophesying to. Your business might be on a billboard. God's about to televise the vision in the name. Your vision is about to be televised. Hallelujah. Someone say it's about to be televised. Not because you asked for it. It's because God want to release it to you. Because you've been that faithful of God. Hallelujah. You've been accountable. I got to televise you. I got to broadcast you. I got got to put you out there, because you don't got the audacity to put yourself out there. And God say, I'm going to do it. It's one thing when God promotes you than when man promotes you. Because if man give you promotion, he'll take your promotion real quick. But when God sets you up with a promotion, man can't take it away, y'all. Ooh, when God sets you up with an anointing, when God sets you up, when the hand of God is over your life, I don't care what man can do. Hallelujah. Man can't rebuke the hand of God that's over your life, but you can rebuke the hand of man that try to come over your life. Man can't do nothing about it. Some say man can't do nothing about this. So don't get mad. Hallelujah. So, yeah, tell them, say, don't get mad. Say, I'm just talking. Say, if me talking going to make you mad, when it come into fruition, when it come to pass, you sure enough going to be jealous. Oh, y'all didn't like Pastor Toya talking about that the other day. We got some jealous people. They jealous. They mad because they can't do what you can do. Yo. Woo, we got some jealous. Y'all ain't gonna help me. You ever dealt with jealous people before? They jealous because you exceed in a certain area that maybe they wasn't anointed to do. They become upset. Glory be to God. Because you gifted in a certain area that they might not be gifted with. You can't be a jealous woman. You can't be a jealous man. Someone said you can't operate in jealousy. Hallelujah. And what happened was Joseph, amen, he began to tell his dream to his brethren, Elder Jones. And after he began to tell his dream to his brethren, amen, what happened, his brother said, you know what? Let's devise a scheme or a plan and let's see what come of his dreams now. They saw him coming before. Hallelujah. But I believe they saw him before he saw them. Your enemies see you coming before you see them. You're just trying to do your job. You're just trying to do your function. Ah, hallelujah. I'm going to keep on preaching. But what happened is your enemy saw you coming even before you got there. Your haters see you coming even before you get there. So they saw him coming. They said, you know what? We got to do something, man. We got to devise a scheme or a plan. Hallelujah. We got to think of something. We don't want his dream to come to pass. So what we got to do, we got to throw him in the pit. Amen. You know what? They was going to try to kill him. They said, no. You know what? We might as well get paid. Reuben said, you know what? Leave the boy alone. Put him in the pit. Then deliver him back to his father. But you know what? It's ironic to me how the praiser say, hold on now. You're a praiser. You're supposed to be a child of God. You know what? Let's make money off of him. Some people only want to be connected with you because they only want to profit off of you. Some folk in the church only want to be with you because they want to profit off of you. Some folk only your Betsy and your friends all because they see what they can get out of you. Hallelujah. What I can get from them. You always pouring into them, but they ain't never pouring into you. So Judah said, you know what? Let's make money off of this boy. So we sold the boy, I believe, for 20 shekels of silver. But before that, he was in a pit. And I can imagine Joseph, what he was thinking at the time. God, I'm in this pit. I had a dream. I had a vision. But how my dream and my vision lead me in the pit? And some of y'all would misinterpret it, the pit. The pit is not the end, but the pit is the beginning of your promise. The pit is the beginning of your dream. Hallelujah. I can imagine Joseph be like, God, this ain't what you showed me. Hallelujah. And if I had a title of this message, I would say, God, this ain't what you showed me. Say, you didn't show me this. It wasn't supposed to look like this. Oh, I can't get no help, nobody. I wasn't supposed to be sick this long. Let me connect with your level and get from the Bible. I wasn't never supposed to get a divorce. It wasn't supposed to be like this. I wasn't supposed to get fired from my job, and they denied my unemployment. I wasn't supposed to get locked up. I wasn't supposed to get laid off. My business was supposed to prosper. Lord, this don't look like what you showed me. Have you ever had a vision from God and all of a sudden it seemed like God got you in a bottom place? He got you in a pit and you feel like, God, this ain't what you showed me. Lord, you showed me greater than this. Because God, if you would have showed me all this hell that I had to go through, I never would have asked for it. I never wanted to be anointed. I can't get no help, nobody. I never wanted to be a minister. I never wanted to pastor. I didn't want this if it caused all this calamity around me. If it caused folk to hate me and I'm just talking and I got a loving heart. I'm a good person. I'm a giving person. If it caused folk to hate me, what you put on me, I don't know if I really want it. See, anybody ever been in that place before? You got folk hating you not because of what you put on yourself. It's because what God put on you. And Joseph had a coat that his father put on him. Joseph's coat wasn't put on by himself. And the anointing over your life, you didn't put that on yourself. But God clothed you in that kind of anointing. And folk getting mad at what God put on you. You mad at me is something I didn't even have nothing to do with it. Because truth be told, I didn't choose God, but God chose me. And some of y'all God didn't choose. He got an assignment he chose you to do. And folk mad because God chose you. He picked you out because you didn't have no ulterior motive. God chose you and gave you the dream because he knew if he gave it to you, you would bring everybody else out. And God didn't choose some of them because he know if God gave it to them, they would just get themselves out. But God say, I'm going to allow my wealth to be transferred into people's hands that ain't just concerned about their self, their kids, their family. But I got to give it to somebody who will spread out the seed beyond their self. Somebody say, you got to go beyond yourself. Hallelujah. So what happened, amen, they threw Joseph in that pit. And I can just see Joseph crying out to God, God, I got betrayed. But it's one thing to get betrayed by friends and co-workers. But it's another thing to get betrayed by family. We say church hurt is the worst hurt. But I think family hurt is the worst hurt. Now church hurt do hurt. But what about your family you grew up with? What about your brothers? What about your father? Y'all ain't gonna help me. And we want to negate that hurt, but as soon as we hear one word wrong in the church, we want to say we church hurt, and we don't want to come to church no more. We don't want to worship no more. Your family hurt you a whole lot longer than the church hurt you. They hurt you for years, and you never left them. You still stayed there. Y'all ain't going to help me. You sit there. You submitted yourself. But the church, one person rolled their eyes at you, and you got mad and made you want to leave the church. Look how immature you are. They rolled their neck at you, and you never want to speak to them again. You got that much unforgiveness in your heart. That somebody done you wrong for 1 minute, one day, 5 years ago, and you never can speak peaceably about them again. They ain't the problem, you the problem. Hallelujah. But the worst hurt is being hurt by family. When family is supposed to support you, when family is supposed to undergird you, when family is supposed to be there for your dreams and your vision, but when you feel like your family ain't there, you'll feel like no one else ain't ever be there before you. I'm dealing with some folk that have been betrayed by their family before. Because when you're betrayed by your family, when someone try to show you real love, you don't know how to trust them because you think they're going to hurt you because they family hurt, because your family hurts you. So when your family hurts you, you don't know how to love properly. So you think every time somebody come in your life, they're going to hurt you. So sometimes we pastors got a hard job to try to love you all because you wait, why they that loving? Why they hug all the time? Why they speak peaceably? It's because we got the love of God in us. We ain't gonna hurt you like that. We gonna cut you with the word though. You ain't gonna feel comfortable in your sin. Yeah. If I don't feel comfortable in my sin, if I done something before I grab this microphone, come on somebody, you can't feel comfortable in your sin. Amen. You need to repent before God quickly. Amen. I know I'm working you, Andre. I'm going to be still. Amen. Say, you got to repent quickly. Hallelujah. And I believe he was confused. Lord, this ain't what you showed me. Amen. I'm supposed to have more members than this. Y'all ain't going to help me. We just got a few people coming in. This ain't what you showed me. Glory. Hallelujah. I just got one contract. Wow. I know you just ain't. I might as well keep my job. This ain't what you showed me. This ain't what you showed me. This ain't what you showed me, God. This ain't what you showed me. You got me making minimum wage when you said I'm the lender and not the borrower. This son of ain't what you showed me. I must be going through hell. What did I do to you, God? What's up? I be like, God, what's up, man? What you tripping on them, bro? What's up? I've been living better, been tithing, give my little $20, $40 seed, $100 seed. Every once in a while, God will speak to me. The pastor don't even have to ask for it. And by the time the pastor asks for $100, it'll already be out of my wallet. And God, you got me going through this. I don't understand. Have anybody ever been that place before with God? Like, God, I don't understand all this now. This don't make no sense at all. At all. In other words, why you got me here? And sometimes we have to ask those questions to God, and even though he don't give an answer, as long as you do it respectfully, it's okay. Why you got me going through this? Why you got me talking to these people that don't like me? Come on. They stabbing me in my back. They trying to do witchcraft and stuff on me. God, I never asked for all this. What's going on? When I see other people that's doing good, but they don't got no good living. They ain't living good, but they doing good. And it's hard to become not jealous of them. Y'all ain't gonna help me. Everything thriving in their life. They sinning, doing any and everything. They got 4 and 5 girlfriends. They ain't gonna help me. And they married. They driving BMW. Black man working. God, I'm black and I'm working. What's up? You forget about a boy? Come on now. And God said, you know what? I got you in a hiding place. I don't want you to be about the stuff. I want your character to be in check before you get tested. Ooh, y'all ain't gonna help me. Because Joseph went through a character check and he passed. If Joseph's character wasn't in check, he would have failed with Potiphar's wife. Y'all ain't gonna help me. But Joseph's character was in check when Potiphar's wife started to look upon Joseph. Because the Bible says Joseph was goodly to look upon. Yeah. But one day Joseph was not covered and no man was around. So he fell because no other man was around. You better make sure some men around when you're around these women. Y'all ain't gonna help me. Because you can fall. I don't care how strong you think you are. But Joseph fleed. I'm going to do a man-up moment called flee fornication. I'm going to get some of them dummies we got, and I'm going to be running from. You got to run, Doc. That's the only way. They're like, don't hit the dummy. Joseph fleed. Hallelujah. He hit the gas. And the Bible say, amen, I want to go to Genesis 39, verse 5. Anybody love the word? We had a good time. And it came to pass, Genesis 39, verse 5, that the time that he made him overseer, this is the first time I saw the word overseer in the Bible, that he made him overseer in his house, and over all that he had. And the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. And the blessing of the Lord was upon all that he had in the house and in the field. In other words, Joseph got sold. But when Joseph got sold, he was sold out by his brothers. But Joseph got sold to his cousins. And his cousins was the Ishmaelites. You got Abraham, come on somebody, but Abraham had Ishmael, hallelujah. So Joseph got sold to his great uncle's people. So Joseph got sold to his own family. Y'all ain't gonna help me. What happens when your family sell you out and your other family sell you out? Your mama and your daddy and your brothers and sisters sell you out. Now your cousins sell you out. So he had it bad on both sides of the family. His brothers sold him out, and his cousins made him a slave. Some of y'all are slave to y'all family. You slave to your family. Soon as your family tell you to do anything, you'll do it real quick. You'll jump up 4 o'clock in the morning and do it. You'll jump up 3 o'clock in the morning and do it. You'll feed their addiction. They had money to pay their bills. It's their fault. Now you taking food from your family table. You taking food out of their mouth. Y'all ain't going to help me to help them when they squandered the money that you already gave them. And they want you to give them why you need this kind of money. They don't want you to ask no question. Come on, somebody. Some of y'all are slaves to y'all family. And God ain't going to bless you no more till you be set free of your family. That's not part of the sermon. That's prophetic. When you stop being a slave of your family, then God can set you free. Maybe he can set your finances free. Stop being a slave to these no good boys and daughters who want to do your money any kind of way. Let them go through their struggle and let God step in their life and show himself mighty and strong. You ain't a God. Can I get any help in the place? Hallelujah. Somebody shout glory. But the Bible say he was in Potiphar's house and Potiphar didn't look after anything because Potiphar looked at Joseph and Potiphar like this. Everything this boy touch is blessed. Every time he do something, the Bible said later on in scripture, God made him prosper. It's one thing when you try to make yourself prosper, but it's another thing when God get all up in your hands, God get all up in your ideas, and God get up all up in your business, and God get up all up in your ministry, and God get up all in your job, and God get up all in your family, that God make you prosper. God's about to allow so much favor to come up on you all that whatever you do, it's going to prosper. Whatever you do, it's going to work. Whatever you try, you're going to be a one-hitter quitter. You're going to do it one time like you've been doing it for 30 years, and it's going to work. I feel a one-time anointing on somebody's life. I thought it one time, and I got it right. One time, Jakar, and I'm going to get it right. One time the nail gonna be in the coffin. One time and I'm gonna hit a home run. One time and I'm gonna hit a three-pointer. One time and I'm gonna make the goal. Somebody shout one time. Hallelujah. Other folk been trying to do it for years. And hallelujah. They doing it with their own business acumen. But God say, when I make you prosper. We can do a lot of stuff on our own, but God say ultimately when man prosper, it's because I cause it to prosper. I'm about to get into the fiber of everything you're trying to do. I'm about to make it work. Amen. Somebody look at your name and say, neighbor. Amen. Say, God's about to make it work. I say, he's going to make it work. He's going to make it work. He's going to make it work. So look at your other name. Say, neighbor, he's going to make it work. He gonna make it work. He gonna make it work. He gonna make it work. So what happened was Joseph was committed of a crime he didn't do. He didn't do it. And some of y'all have been locked up in situations and you didn't do nothing.
Amen.
Everybody say that. I didn't do nothing. They got me here for no reason. But some of y'all truly have been falsely accused.
Amen.
By friends and family and you didn't do nothing to them. But you so mature, you apologize for something you didn't even do. Have anybody ever apologized for something that they did not do? I'm saying I'm sorry and I'm heartfelt about it, but to be honest, I didn't do nothing to you. All I did was be blessed. All I did was try to help you. I never tried to hurt you. I had no ulterior motives against you. I didn't do nothing to you. And why are you so mad at me? What you mad at me for? What you looking at me crazy for? Why you block my number when I call? Why when I'm about to park and you right in front of me, you take up two parking spots? Why you? You know I was right behind you. Your car ain't that big to take two parking spots. Now I got to park way yonder way. Why'd you do that to me? You know you don't like bacon on your burger, but when I go to Burger King, they run out of bacon. You say you want bacon. Why'd you do me like that? Why'd you do me like that? Why'd you do me like that? Some people do you wrong, and you ain't do nothing to them. And they trying to hold you captive because their emotions. Don't allow other people's emotions to hold you captive. You can be mad at me till I die or till you die. You ain't going to stop my joy. I'm not going to let you stop my joy. I shout all over your face. Y'all ain't going to help me. I shout all over your mouth. I shout all over your body. You better move and leave me. I don't got no time to be trying to cater to you. If you don't like me, you just don't like me. If you hate me, do something about it. Just stay over there. Dwayne, you know how we used to do back in the day. Cross this line right here, mate. You talking that Noah, cross this line. As a matter of fact, put that stick on the shoulder. You put that stick on the shoulder, that means you ready to throw down. Y'all ain't gonna help me. Yeah, see, some of y'all ain't never had them kind of fight. You better not dare say nothing about my mama. I dare you say something. I'm about to set it off in that place. I don't care how crazy my mama is. Let me say my mama crazy. Don't you say my mama crazy. Yeah. I don't care how she look. I don't care how she talk. I don't care if she a crackhead. Don't you talk about my mama. Some of y'all don't got that kind of respect. Come on, somebody. I don't even care if your mama died. You still don't talk about my mama. Nobody got no love for their mama like that? Somebody say, bet not. Even if it's true, just shake your head and keep on moving. Don't say nothing about, come on. Be very careful how you use your words when it comes against my mama. Y'all ain't gonna hear me. Y'all see a preacher jump from the pulpit, talk about his mama. Jump down like a wrestler from the top rope. You gonna be crazy talking about people's mamas. Walk lightly. Y'all ain't gonna. I'm just messing with y'all. That WWF, that's right. So what happened? Joseph was locked up for something he didn't do. You know what? What happened when it seemed like your vision got you locked up? Your vision seemed like it got you isolated. It seemed like you locked up to the vision God gave you that you can't get out of it. But the Bible say, amen, he was accused of this crime, and Potiphar, amen, what he did, he made sure he was locked up, but he was in the prison of the king's, hallelujah, of the king's prisoner. So Joseph was at the bottom, but he still was at the top. He wasn't with the regular people when he got locked up. Y'all ain't gonna hear me. And some of y'all locked up, but you still ain't regular. You in a financial situation, but you still ain't regular. Hallelujah. Yeah. You just might be making $8, $9, $10, but you're still not regular. Look at your name and say, name, say, I'm not regular. Say, what God put on me and what God put in me, say, it's not average. Say, it's not regular. So what happened was, and we're moving on, Joseph was locked up, and he was locked up, and the prisoner, the end of the prisoner said, you know what, Joseph, I see the favor over your life, and I'm paraphrasing, I'm going to allow you to be in charge over all the prisoners. He was trustee. I'm locked up, but you made trustee. I'm locked up. They won't let you now. He was locked up, but he was still running stuff. Have you ever been in a low place in your life, but you still had managerial skills? Woo, God is trying to perfect something, because something greater is going to come out of this. I know it don't look like it, but God say, just hang on in there, because something greater going to come out of this. So he was locked up by a dream, and he was locked up, and you know what? He was still running stuff. The prison said, you know what? I got me a good old boy here. Amen. I don't got to do nothing till I drink coffee, eat donuts. Amen. He going to run everything for me. Amen. And he going to make me look good. Right. When you got good people on your team, they don't care about making you look good. Joseph didn't care about all that attention. Joseph wanted to do what God gifted him to do, was to manage and to control stuff. And he didn't have no arrogant, haughty attitude when he done it. See, God can't trust some of us to run stuff because we got a bad attitude. We arrogant. We haughty. We think we done it. We don't give glory to God. And this is very important. I want you to pay attention to this. Joseph, anyway, he was... So some other prisoners came. It was the butler and the baker. They came. And when the butler and the baker came, you guys know the story. Hallelujah. The king rebuked them and sent them, amen, to jail or the prison. But one night, they both had a dream. They both had a dream. And they woke up looking sad. And Joseph, in my mind, should have been in a sadder situation. Because it's something he did not do that got him in prison. But they done something that got them in prison. The butler neglected his responsibilities. I don't know what he did, but he wasn't being an effective cupbearer. And the baker, I don't know exactly what the baker did, but the baker didn't bake the meat right. I don't know if no seasoning was in. I don't know. I don't know if the king ate some raw chicken, come on, and got salmonella poison. I don't know. The Bible didn't say so. I don't know. I don't know if he didn't put the bacon and put the paprika on there, or it wasn't no seasoning salt on there, or maybe it wasn't no garlic. See, y'all don't know nothing about cooking if you don't know nothing about no seasoning. I'm getting hungry right now, boy. I tell you right now. If you don't be trying to cook now, if you don't know how to season your food. You can't put too much salt. That's what's wrong with the church. Some of y'all too salty. You're too salty. We're supposed to be the salt of the earth, but how are we going to be the salt of the earth if you always giving sugar all the time? The church can't be the salt of the church, because salt of the world, and we always try to sugarcoat the word of God. You need to stop eating sweets and learn to eat the meat and the word of the God. You got to have the right mixture of salt and also sweetness at the same time. So when you taste it, it won't be bitter. So when you taste it, it'll learn to be sweet a little bit. I can't get no help, nobody. But the problem was at the wood was that, you know what? Joseph looked at them and said, You know what, man, you look sad. What happened? And he began to tell him, you know, I had a dream, and you know, I was a cupbearer, and all of a sudden, in the dream was three branches, and not three branches, it was some grapes, and they were squeezed, and I'm trying to figure out what's going on. So Joseph still had a positive attitude, although he was locked up. And some of y'all will never have any opportunities or no more doors open for you because you're in a situation where you feel like you locked up, but your attitude is bad. I don't want people to serve me who got a bad attitude. I'm going to clap for myself for that. If you got a bad attitude, sit down. If I got a bad attitude, you think I'm going to preach to y'all? Come on now. Don't serve if your attitude is jacked up. Don't talk to folk crazy. Don't y'all young. Oh Lord, I don't care how talented you are, but when your attitude is nasty, you a nasty person. So Joseph, you know what? He had a good attitude. You know what? What's going on? He trying to cheer up them when they really should be trying to cheer up him. How you try to cheer up somebody when God got you in a season of isolation and being locked up? You've been in there for I don't know how long years, and they just been in there for a couple of days, and you cheering them up. What kind of sense did that make? I've been in this situation for years in my life, and you've been in this situation for a week, and I'm encouraging you and telling you God don't do it when God haven't done it for me yet. God say, I'm about to bless some people like that. I haven't done it for them yet, but they've been telling everybody God gonna do it for me. God haven't healed my body yet, but I'm praying that God heal and anoint you. God haven't packed out my church yet, but I pray God pack your church out. And I mean it with all sincerity of my heart. Of my heart. So we say, what's wrong? Look at your name. Say, what's wrong with you? Why are you so sad? Why are you so mad? Why are you so depressed? My nephew used to tell me all the time, he had good discernment. He know when I get mad, he'll stick his hand on my shirt and say, Uncle, you mad? No, I ain't mad, Michael. You sure you mad? You mad? Like, no, I ain't mad. By the time you get through talking to me, I ain't mad no more. And some of y'all just mad because ain't nobody giving you no attention. No, you brightening up the video with your beauty. It's good. See, I'm young, but you got to have that old school love. That old school love, what's going to land? I'm trying to teach y'all something. That new stuff is all right. I'm talking about some Jodeci, y'all. Forever my lady. Yeah. See, y'all see, y'all ain't going to hear me. I like, that man got himself his call to the ministry the way he preaching. Y'all ain't going to help me. But anyway, that's a random moment. Random moments come out, one of those random moments. I don't know. But what happened? Yeah, we got to get out of here. But what happened was, yeah, I know it. He began to tell him his dream, and he start to interpret his dream. Say, you know what? In 3 days, you're going to be back restored. And when you be back restored, you're going to be back in the position that you got defrocked, or you're going to be back in the position that the king put you out of. You're like, okay, good. Then the other baker said, you know what? He got a good interpretation of a prophecy, of a dream. Let me go.
Yeah, let me go over there.
Some of y'all think y'all want prophecy. You go step in that line, and they told somebody else something good. You get told something bad. You're going to be looking crazy. I thought they were going to tell me a good thing. They told me I need to pay my tithe. I need to pay my offering. They told me I need to pray. I ain't going to never come to church no more. I thought I wanted the prophetic word. But the prophetic word revealed to me my pathetic situation. Sometime a prophetic word will reveal to you your pathetic situation. Just because she got told something good don't mean you got told something good. Just because he got told something good don't mean you going to get told something good. You jumping in every line. Y'all ain't going to have me talking here. You so open to every prophetic word. All kind of demons that attack your mind, your family, your kids, that have been attacked in your bloodline. If it ain't from my leaders, if it ain't from the DNA of my bishop, I rebuke it in the name of Jesus. I don't care what you said accurately that was right over my life, but I denounce every wrong thing that you said, and I reject it out of my life in the name of Jesus. You got to denounce some things that's been spoken over your life. I denounce sickness. I denounce being depressed because my mama stayed depressed. I denounce being a whoremonger because my daddy was a whoremonger. I denounce it in the name of Jesus. Just because my daddy was don't mean I got to be. Just because your mama used to tip and all be between the streets don't mean you got to be in the streets. I rebuke it in the name. The buck stops with me. It stops with me. Just because some other preachers may be about money don't mean I'm going to be about the money. It got to stop somewhere. Look at your name and say, neighbor. Say, it stops with me. So he began to interpret his dream and say, you know what? The three branches I'm paraphrasing. You can read it at your own time. The three branches mean 3 days, and it means 3 days. And what's going to happen, you're going to be hanged, and the bird's going to eat of your flesh. I'm like, how can you sleep after that? Lord, I just rather it just happen unexpectedly. It's more torture that it's going to happen before it happened. So all of a sudden they got raised up, and he told him, he said, you know what? He told a butler, when you get up there, don't forget about me. I didn't do anything to be in this place.
Amen.
So as soon as the butler got delivered, he didn't tell him nothing. Why people do that? They get delivered and they forget about you. They get their money and they forget about you. Y'all ain't gonna, you help keep their kids.
Amen.
I'm talking about some baby kids. You help raise. Y'all ain't gonna help me talking. I'm talking about they don't die, they multiply. Y'all ain't gonna help me talking here. You gave them sugar when they just had Kool-Aid. You was there for them. You gave them money. You let them use your food stamp card. Your WIC benefits. Y'all ain't gonna help me. You put money in their bank account, and as soon as they got delivered, they forgot about you. How that make you feel? Man, I interpreted your dream. I gave you a good prophetic word. Glory, I prayed over it. I fasted for you. I labored with you. I prayed for your sons. And your hard had daughters casting devils out of them. And you treat me like this. You complain over giving $20. You complain about it. That was anointed. Put that back up. You complain about it. Hallelujah. And all of a sudden, you treat me like this. So what happened was the dream came to pass, and the butler, we're not going to read no more scriptures. We're going to just paraphrase and get out of here. But the butler said, you know what? You know what? He forgot about him. But one day, Pharaoh had a dream.
What you talking about?
The main man had a dream. Somebody say, the main man. Somebody shout, I'm about to get attention from the main man. I'm talking about the top dog. The top dog is about to call for me. I'm talking about the top dog. So what happened, he had a dream. He couldn't interpret, and he called all the magicians and all the wise men. And so you know what? I had a dream, and it was seven cows, and there was fat and full, and there was seven gunk cows, and the ugly cows, they began to eat the good cows. Now, first of all, there's something wrong with that dream, because cows don't eat meat.
Amen.
They eat grass. So what that look like, y'all ain't gonna help me. You got a cow that's eating meat. So I've got a problem with this vision and this dream that God gave me. I need an interpretation. So what happened was no one could interpret his dream. He said, hey, it was seven corn that looked good that came out, and it was seven corn that wasn't good, and they devoured the good corn. So no one could interpret his dream. But he said, hold on, there is a man. Hallelujah. When I was in jail, when Pharaoh was wroth with me, when you was mad at me and you rebuked me, and I had a vision and he interpreted, and it was a young man, by the way, and he's locked up in a situation right now. Maybe he can interpret your dream. When people forget about you, God will cause a situation that they cannot forget about. They forgot about you, but it's something that's going to be put in demand. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. God will cause a situation to arise that no one else can give the solution but you.
Amen.
Somebody say, I'm about to be the solution. So what happened, he came up to Pharaoh, and the Bible say they delivered him immediately, and he changed his raiment, and he shaved his head. I can't get no play, no help, nobody. He changed his clothes because he knew he was about to meet King Pharaoh. And some of us, God about to set us up to another place, but we don't want to change ourselves. We don't want to change our raiment. We don't want to change our attire. You better look like you're going somewhere. You're about to meet the king. So Pharaoh told him the dream and said, well, don't worry about it, Pharaoh. Interpretation belongs to God. I'm going to interpret this dream, but I'm not going to take credit because God gets all the glory. And he said, you know what? The seven good casts means 7 years. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. And the seven bad casts means 7 bad years. So what Pharaoh needs to do is to appoint a wise man to grab a fifth of the land and get all the corn and store it back. And he said, well, appoint somebody wise. And Pharaoh said, you know what? If you was wise enough to interpret it, then maybe you are wise enough to be over it. If God allows you to see it, God don't allow you to live in it. God ain't just gonna show you no stuff that ain't gonna manifest in your life. If God showed me, God gonna make it come to pass in my life. At the woods, you can get ready and bring that stuff. Another man, give him some help. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, if God showed it to me, say, it surely can come to pass. But the problem is we think God can't do it. But somebody shout, but he can do it. Why would he show you coming out if it wasn't his intentions for you to be brought out? Why would he show you being prosperous and having more than enough if God didn't want you to be prosperous and have more than enough? Amen. Why would he show you being healed, delivered, and set free if it never was God's intentions for you to be healed, delivered, and set free? So God's showing you what you're going to become. But I'm so glad, hallelujah, I'm so glad that the fact that Joseph's attitude didn't deter him from his blessing. Joking, like, you know what, God, you got me in jail. I ain't finna interpret no Negro dreams. I ain't finna prophesy to nobody. I ain't finna preach to nobody. I ain't finna encourage nobody when I need encouragement myself. And some of y'all attitude that bad, you're gonna miss your opportunity. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, don't let your attitude make you miss your opportunity. You know what? I want to ask for something else. Can I get some ice? Just a little revelation I think I can deal with. You can put some in it. If it's some, if not, don't worry about it. Hallelujah. What we got here? Somebody catch it. Catch it. You kind of fall back there. All right. Yeah. Duck empty. I don't want you to get hit in the forehead. Now. Oh, he caught it. Oh, come on now. You don't got to throw. You can screw up a little bit closer. All right. Put a little ice in that right there for me. Yes, Lord. Yes. Thank you, Lord. This texture, this is a commodity. All right. My sweat towel. All right. Throw me that lemon, Pastor Latoya. Sometime life throws you lemons. Hallelujah. But sometimes we don't want to catch our lemons. But that's your lemon and that's your responsibility. You got to learn how to deal with it. What happens when life throws you curveballs you never expected? You never thought you was going through the heartache. You never thought they would die. You never thought they would get divorced. You never thought that your car was going to be a lemon and you just got it from the car lot. You never thought. And you found out you got a dud, you got a lemon, you got all these problems, you just barely got that car, you got to pay $1,000. So sometimes life gives you lemons. Minister, man, throw me that lemon. Y'all see that? Y'all see that? Cut that good hands. Found me a contract. So oftentimes life throw you lemons, but sometimes you guys don't want to go through the process, so you get this artificial stuff. Whoa. This artificial lemonade don't taste like no real lemonade. And some of y'all going through some authentic trials and tribulations in your life. You need something real. Someone says, I need something authentic. So when life gives you lemons, you got to learn how to relax and deal with it. I told him to put some ice in here, which means some of y'all just need to learn how to chill out. Chill out. Just
Relax.
God are going to allow you to make some lemonade, but what happened, you just see a lemon thrown at you, but you're not seeing your lemon going to aid you. Lemon aid. Your lemon's going to aid you for the next season and the next level in your life. How can lemon aid you? Why? Because when you're thirsty, come on somebody, it'll quench your thirst. But so you know what? Pray I don't cut myself, y'all, please. Yeah, you got the nice skill. I should let you do it. I got something that's already cut up, but I want to show out a little bit. I like to do this kind of stuff, make my wife nervous.
Come on, man.
That's really the only reason why I done it.
I do it too. Come on.
Because I had prepared lemons, but I just wanted to get her nervous because I know how she likes to think. But what happened is when life throws lemons, when you first taste it, it's real bitter. And sometimes life throws you lemons, when you taste it, it's bitter. But in order for it to get unbitter, you got to add water. So sometimes you be in a situation where you're empty, but God said you need more of the Spirit. You chilled out now, and now you got the Spirit of God. The problem is some of y'all don't got the Holy Ghost. When you don't got the Holy Ghost, you just look at this as a lemon, and you don't know how to use the lemon that's going to aid you. So what happened is, you know what? Real lemons, when you're making lemonade, it has to be squeezed. And some of y'all in a process, and you know what? The enemy, I won't say really throw me this lemonade. God allowed the enemy to throw me this lemon. And we often blame it on the enemy when God allowed the enemy to mess with your stuff. He allowed the enemy to do it. So don't be like, you know, it was the devil that threw him. No. God allowed him to do it because he wanted you to see something that you didn't see before. You thought this was a lemon, but you had to open it up. And some of y'all going through things, and you got to see beyond what it is right now. It's a lemon right now, but when God get through with me, my lemon is going to aid me. It's bitter right now, but when God get through with me, this bitter going to turn into something real sweet. And some of y'all got to be squeezed. You got to be crushed. Andre, don't you start that stuff. Because I have knocked this all over. Y'all get out of here. Don't you do that, Andre. Please, please. Hold yourself together. Come on, Dobo Shy. They're like, what happened? I see lemonade going everywhere in that church. Sorry, I ain't lying, Dwayne. And it's something about freshly squeezed lemons. Hallelujah. I ain't talking about no lemons that's been sitting out all day. You don't know what then got on them. I can't get no help, nobody. I'm going to do another one. Amen. Yeah. You ain't careful when you get squeezed. Sometimes you'll squeeze it and try to direct it in a certain area. But when you're not careful, it'll go all over the place. So sometimes when God crushing you, everybody know about it. You done got in the other four eyes. You done got in the other people's mouth. They all know about what you're going through because you've been squeezed with so much pressure that you can't contain yourself. You can't be contained. So what happened is I tasted it. It's all right. It's a little bit. It's not as bitter. It's digestible, but it's not sweet. And this right here is called sweet and low. You got to do a sweet and low package like this. We do know that, right? And the problem, the enemy thought that you've been in a low spot, but he thought you was going to be bitter, but he didn't know you was going to be sweet.
So the lower you got, the sweeter you got. The enemy thought the lower you was going to get, the more bitter you was going to come out. I might have went in bitter, but I'm going to come out sweet. You can be mad and bitter at me all you want to and hate me. I'm going to be sweet to you. I'm going to be nice to you. I'm going to pray for you. Roll your eyes, put your hand on your hip. Hate on me, do ever what you want to do to me, man, but I'm still going to be nice to you. So what happens is, you know what? I got to, hallelujah, show them kindness. And some people, one is good enough for them. They satisfied with one. One ain't good enough for me. I probably need some sugar up here too. But we all good. Y'all don't got to get nothing else. I'm like, you all right. And I don't know about no splendor. I like me some sweet and low. So I put another one in there. And what happened is, if I was to drink it, I'd drink all the sweetness, but the rest of it would be bitter. So what the Lord does, he allows us to go through a process where we have to be stirred up. And some of y'all, God is stirring up right now. You didn't see what God was doing, but it's going to work out for your good. Life threw you lemons, but God's going to make, hallelujah, he's going to allow you to taste it, and it's going to turn from being bitter to being better. Glory be to God. You didn't see how it was going to work out, but it's going to find a way to work out for your good. Just allow the hand of God to stir you up. Your bitterness is leaving now. You're getting sweeter. You're becoming nicer. You went low, but instead of getting mad, you got humble. You went low, but when you went low, you discovered your prophetic gift. You discovered that, you know what? I just can't interpret my dreams, but you know what? I can interpret other people's dreams now. You went low and discovered, you know what? I'm a business owner. I got millionaire potential locked up inside of me. And the enemy thought he was, the best thing the enemy could have done with you was throw you in that pit. While you was in that pit, you was getting stirred. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, the best thing the enemy could have done to me is put me in the pit. It's to put me in the dungeon. He didn't even know I was going to use those lemons you was throwing at me. I was good enough to catch it and to squeeze it. I'm about to make lemon. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm about to make lemonade. I'm finna make some lemonade. And back in the day, when you make some lemonade, you can have a lemonade stand. Amen. And you got a business. What happened when, I should say it like this, out of your pain come your purpose? This was supposed to hurt you. But out of your pain, you found purpose. Everybody's not doing what the potential, what you can be doing with this. So God said, you know what? That's why you got to get the knife, because some of y'all got to be cut on. And some of y'all will never get to this unless you use this. You got to allow God's word to cut on you. Everybody shout that by. Y'all scared of me because I got this knife speaking in tongues. Like I'm finna act a fool and nut up. So I understand why y'all holding your praise. God got to cut on you now. I'm going to tell you like that. You want him doing it natural and the spirit. He got to cut on you. You got to deal with it. Amen. Come on, I need to make an example. I'm playing with y'all. I put another one in there. Y'all thirsty, huh? God will give you something where you won't thirst anymore. You've been thirsty, but you ain't been drinking the right stuff. You've been thirsty for attention, and attention, you still thirsty. You've been thirsty for a man. Now you got a man. Now you want another one. You've been thirsty for the wrong thing. You've been thirsty for a job, but now you got a job. You don't like that job, so you get another one. You've been thirsty for the wrong thing. You've been thirsty for the wrong thing. But you ought to be thirsty after the things of God. Amen. And you got to do it like that, too. You got to tap it. And also, you got to have one on the outside to let people know that you got your lemonade. That's a nice glass, Dwayne. And I wash my hands because
You know, you want to make sure your hands clean when you're serving.
Amen.
And some people serve, but their hands ain't clean.
Amen.
And when you serve, when your hands ain't clean, you get locked up in jail like the butler.
Wow.
Amen.
And the butler got locked up in jail because he was the cupbearer to the king. Y'all ain't going to help me. But he something was wrong with his serving. But the baker got kicked out and got killed, and he never was to return again. So even though if your hands weren't clean, the Lord said, wash your hands. Before you serve, wash your hands. Make sure your mouth ain't on the ministry. Make sure your mouth is not on the things of God. Because I don't want you serving us if your mouth's not clean. I don't want you serving us if your hands not clean. I don't want all your hands and all my limbs if your hand dirty. The devil is a liar. Clean between your fingernails. Y'all ain't going to help me. See, I look for little stuff like this. I don't want nobody squeezing their lemons if your hands is filthy. I'm not saying you got to be perfect, but you better get some Dial soap. You better clean them nails. I don't want that dirt to get infected in what I'm about to drink. You're going to make me sick with your dirty self. But the problem is we don't like to be clean. Sure, I'm thirsty. That's pretty good. Adrian, that's pretty good. I know I'm serving. I ain't still studying, y'all. I'm still going to eliminate. I'm glad we have some ice back there, too. That made it just right. I think I'm going to finish this, y'all. Excuse me. I am sufficed. You can leave it there. Hallelujah. And I would like to conclude with this. When life gives you lemons, hallelujah, make lemonade out of it.
Amen.
I got that from the women's conference.
Amen.
That's what the women talked about, right? From bitter to better.
Amen.
Some of y'all go from worse to worse.
Glory.
I know when after it get bad, it get worse, at some point of time, it's supposed to get better. Your situations are about to change. Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Catch your lemons.
Yes.
Do something with them.
Yeah.
It's a good catch. Now what you going to do with it? Okay, Elder Wood trying to throw out with that one. All right, Elder Wood. What you going to do with it? What you going to do with it? Play us something that put us in worship for a moment. Oh, come on, that's all right. You're a young kid. We'll give you a chance. Throw it back. Throw it back. Hallelujah. Somebody shout glory.
Glory.
Allow your lemons to be turned. Somebody shout the lemonade.
Lemonade.
Some say move from bitter,
move from bitter
into being a whole lot better. Come on, open up your mouth. Give God praise all over the place. Come on, somebody give God worship. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody give God praise. Somebody give God honor. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Begin to hold hands with a wealthy worshiper. After this, I mean, we're going to give and sow and invest in the God's kingdom and his word. Hallelujah. Y'all not going to like this prophetic word I give you all. But when I give it to you, now you got the wisdom to know how to deal with it. Some of y'all going to get thrown more lemons in your life.
Amen.
It's inevitable. It's going to happen. But what you do with what's thrown in your life determine if it's digestible. You can have your face look like you've been sucking on a sour lemon your whole life. But until you do something different and add the necessary ingredients, the water,
looking to buy heavy equipment,
the word of God, the lemons, and although you went low, you got sweet, you will never have any real change in your life. So I encourage you on today, do the best with what God gave you, where you can move from being bitter into being a whole lot better. Somebody say, I used to be bitter, but I'm getting better. Say, I've been in a low spot, but it made me sweeter. See, I've been in a hard place, but now my harvest is coming. Begin to open up your mouth and give God praise. Your harvest is about to come out of your low place. Your harvest is going to come out of your bitter place. You're about to experience a better life, a better marriage. You're about to be a better man, a better husband. You're about to be a better worker, a better employer, a better employee, a better manager. Come on, open up your mouth and give God praise. It's turning around for you. I dare you look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, say it's turning around for me. Come on, I dare just begin to open up your mouth, begin to shout, begin to get your voice of triumph. God is changing it. He's turning it around. Come on and give him praise. Open up your mouth and give him glory. It's turning around for you. It's turning around. That's a corporate prophetic word for you out there. It's turning around. Yep, I don't care what it looked like. It looked bitter, but drop that I and put that E. But it's going to get better. It's getting 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 better. Yeah, I know. I know it seemed like it's getting worse. I know you've been at a place in the pit, and it seemed like you're not going to come out of there. I know your family sold you out. But it turned around for Joseph. Joseph ended up being second in command. And whatever he said, it went. It's getting better for me. It's getting better for me. So I don't care if nobody else believe in your vision. I'm going to say it and prophesy to my, it's getting better for me. I dare you begin to prophesy over your own life. Say, it's getting better. Say, my dreams don't come to pass. Say, I'm going to be a better man. Say, I'm not going to be a bitter man. Say, I'm going to be a better woman. I'm not going to be a bitter woman. Yeah, 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 yeah. Your kids not going to be bitter kids. But what happens, bitter men and women birth bitter kids. Your kids ain't going to be bitter. Your kids going to be better and greater than you. We're moving bitterness out of the way. And that word bitterness, you got bite. The bite of the enemy. It's not going to have the long-lasting effect against you. And some of y'all been bit. You've been bit by the enemy. Hallelujah. You've been bit. Your praise is gone. You've been bit. Your commitment is gone. You've been bit. Your worship ain't the same. You've been bit. You don't give like you're supposed to. You've been bit. You've been bit by lies, by scandals. You've been bit by the enemy. But God said, you know what? Take that lemon. Make some lemonade. Let God squeeze you. Let him crush you. Let him anoint you. Come on, open up your mouth and give God praise all over the place. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. If you believe it's turning around, I dare everybody to stand up on their feet. Just for about a few minutes, just begin to turn around. God, my situation is turning around. Lord, the ministry is turning around. The members' mindset are turning around. Yes, Lord. God, my mindset is turning around. Lord, my business is turning around. I dare you begin to turn around and prophesy over your life, over your family, over your education, over your body. It's turning around.
It's turning around.
Come on. Yeah, 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 yeah. Reboko Reba Sarabande Bahaba. It's turning around. 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 I'm about to cause growth in every believer life, said the Lord. I'm about to cause multiplication. Favor and increase. Men are going to see of the favor of God that's going to be released over your life. Hallelujah. Potiphar saw the favor that was on Joseph's life. Potiphar's wife saw the favor that was on Joseph's life. Hallelujah. Pharaoh saw the favor that was on Joseph's life, and it elevated him past his conviction. It elevated him past, glory be to God. The enemy tried to label some of you all. Hallelujah. The enemy tried to label some of you all. But God said, I'm going to put something so much dynamite in you that you're going to be in so much demand, whatever label that the enemy put on you, it ain't going to stop you. I don't care if you've been convicted about doing it, it still ain't going to stop you. Because something greater in you. I guarantee you, Elder Jones, Pharaoh wasn't worried about what Potiphar was trying to say right then. I got a dream that needs to be interpreted. I don't care what you got to say, Potiphar. You know your wife hot to twat anyway. You know she hot to twat, and you know he probably don't deserve it. So I don't got nothing to say to you right now, Potiphar. I'm greater than you. Forget what you said. You can't interpret my dream. You can say whatever you want to say against my men and women and God. You can say whatever you want to say against the saints. Forget what you said. You can't break me out. You can't deliver me. You can't set me free. Keep your bitter talking to yourself. Keep it to yourself. Keep whatever to yourself. I don't got time to deal with your bitterness. Hallelujah. I need a word that's going to cause me to be getting better. That's going to make me wiser. That's going to preserve my generation. That's going to preserve my family. Joseph had a vision, and his family was the benefactor of his vision. They were saved. They was brought out of the famine. Hallelujah. Because of Joseph, his dream manifested, and it finally came to pass. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's finally going to come to pass. If you believe that, shout about it and open up your mouth and give God glory. The toast. All the hell you've been through. Celebrate. Hallelujah. It's supposed to be sour, but it ended up being so sweet. It's supposed to be hard, but it ended up being your harvest. It's supposed to be pathetic, but God ushers you into the prophetic. Hallelujah. It's supposed to be your demise or your funeral, but it sets you up for your future. It turned around. He turned it around. Somebody give God glory. As you're standing, yesterday during the women's